thank you very much. So first of all, I would like to thank the opportunity, being here. It's a wonderful conference. And so now I will... I should not use it. Okay. Yeah, thank you. So I will talk about entanglement detection between two spatially separated atomic ensembles. And so on the one part, there are theorists in this project, like Giuseppe Vitaiano, Jagoba Pajanic, and Matthias Kleiman from my group. So I'm Geza Toth. And on the other hand, the experimentalists are Carsten Lange, Jan Peise, Ben Lücke, Ilka Kruse, and Carsten Klemt from the group of Carsten Klemt from Hannover. So here I show you where I work. So I work in North Spit from the sea. So now, let's say, the motivation of my talk. So why entanglement detection is important? So many experiments are aiming to create highly entangled states, and it's clear one cannot make a full tomography to obtain the entire quantum state. They measure many things, mostly only collective observables, but you should say something meaningful about the state prepared. And it turns out that it's a good idea to claim that entanglement was present in the experiment or try to verify the presence of entanglement. So what is entanglement? I would like to summarize it first. So I hope that you hear me, no? So qubit or n-particle quantum state is called separable if it can be written like this, as a mixture of product states. And if a state cannot be written like this, then the state is called entangled. And if you have very many particles, it is a good idea also to talk about different levels of multipartite entanglement. And for that, we can define k-producible states. So a pure k-producible state is just a tensor product of states of at most k qubits. And the mixed k-producible state is just the mixture of such pure k-producible states. And if a state cannot be written like this, so it's not k-producible, then we can say that it contains k plus one particle entanglement. So this is a usual notion to study many particle systems. So now we talked about entanglement in such systems. Now we should see what can be measured in such systems. So of course, as I said, you can measure typically collective observables, because if you have 1 million atoms, then you cannot address the atoms individually. So you can measure, let's say, the sum of collective angular momentum operators, the sum of individual single particle angular momentum operators. So you can measure Jx, Jy, Jz. And in practice, this means that you can measure the expectation values of these operators, and you can measure their variances. And in principle, you can try to measure higher order moments, but it will need more and more experiments, longer and longer experiments. So somehow we should claim entanglement based on these quantities and verify the presence. Works like this. So there is this expression, and the claim is that for separable states, it's never smaller than one. And if this quantity is smaller than one, then the state is entangled. So let's see that what kind of states produce smaller than one value. So first of all, in one direction, here you should have a large spin. So in the denominator, you should have a large value, and in the numerator, you should have a small value, so this variance should be small. So in practice, these are states which have a large variance in one direction, a large spin in one direction, and a small variance in an orthogonal direction. So these states are called spin squeeze states. And it's clear why they are good for metrology, because you can use them to measure rotation angle, in this case, a rotation around the y direction. There are also other entanglement criteria that detect entanglement with collective quantities. And here we managed to find a full set of them for spin half particles. So let's assume that we know these. So we know the expectation values of the collective spin components, and we know also the second moments. And from these six quantities, one can detect entanglement using these equations. So it means that for separable states, these are satisfied. And if a state violates one of them, then it is entangled. And by the way, this is also satisfied by any quantum states, this first equation. The second equation is such that multipartite singlets violate it maximally. So it means that this is good for detecting singlet states. And the third equation is interesting. I will discuss it later because it's good for Dicke states. So now this is a full set for spin half. And you can imagine it like that, that let's say we fix the first moments. All the three are now zero. Then in the space of the second moments, these equations correspond to this polytope. And any point inside the polytope satisfies all the equations. But if there is a point corresponding, so there is a point outside of the polytope, then the corresponding state violates one of those equations. And these green dots are separable states. So they are all inside the polytope. So it suggests that, let's say, we did not make probably a mistake in this calculation. So it means that separable states cannot violate these equations. And you see that they are also filling this polytope fully, so it means that we cannot add one more entanglement condition, which would be another phase or another plane. And you can also observe that all these quantities can be computed from the average two-body density matrix, which you can see here. So all the first moments and second moments are just functions of the average two-body density matrix. Interestingly, we can still detect entanglement in this large system, and we can even detect multipartite entanglement. So I will show how it works. So first, I will talk about multipartite entanglement detection, and after, about a recent result with bipartite entanglement. So far I was reviewing other issues like entanglement detection, but now I will, or spin squeeze states, I will concentrate on Dicke states. So what are these Dicke states? Of course, they appear in the famous work of Dicke from 1954. They are just the eigenstates of J square operator, which you can also write Jx square plus Jy square plus Jz square and Jz. So they are simultaneous eigenstates of these two. And we are interested in the Dicke state for which this Jz expectation value is zero, and they are symmetric, and due to that, this J square is maximal. And these states look like this. So these are just a symmetric superposition of half of the atoms in zero state, and half of them are in one state. You can write it for four qubits like that. You see that 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. So all the permutations of two zeros, two ones. And such states have been created for four qubits, for six qubits with photons, and also in cold atoms with thousands of particles. You can immediately say, why is Jz zero? Because you have equal number of zeros and ones, so it's clear that the Jz expectation value will be zero, and even it's an eigenstate of Jz with a zero eigenvalue. So it's a very interesting state. So it possesses strong multipartite entanglement, like the Jz state. It's optimal for quantum metrology, so you can reach with it Heisenberg scaling, very close to the Heisenberg limit. And it's also macroscopically entangled according to these definitions, which are based on quantum Fisher information. And I would add that it's also robust to particle loss. So it's unlike the Jz state, it can survive particle loss and remains entangled. So this was this equation what I wrote last time. So the statement is that this is true for separable states, and if it is violated, then the state is entangled, and the Dicke states maximally violate it. because for a Dicke state, this Geza square is zero, so not only Geza is zero, but the variance is zero, so then Geza square is zero, but the variance in the other two directions is big. So the sum of them is maximal. So it means that for the Dicke state, this is big, this is zero, and then the Dicke state is detected as entangled by this condition. So I will explain later why is it interesting. So they use this condition to detect entanglement for the Dicke state in a cold gas experiment. On this axis, you can see this Jx square plus Jy square expectation value normalized, and here Jz square, or variance of Jz. And as I said, for the Dicke state, ideally this is zero, and this thing is maximal. So the ideal Dicke state should be here. The experiment corresponds to a point there. These are uncertainty ellipses with one and two standard deviations around the experimental point. And this equation corresponds to this line. So it means that if we have a point which is below this line, then we know that the state is entangled. So you see that this is the line corresponding to separability. But we also worked out a theory that has lines for 10 particle, 20 particle, 30 particle entanglement. And here they could show 28 particle entanglement because simply this is the line that is touching the second uncertainty ellipse. I would not explain how these lines were calculated because this is not the main topic of my talk, but you can understand the idea that you measure two quantities, and even if they depend on two-body density matrices, you can just say that the state is 28 or 100 particle entangled. So again, this Dicke state has an uncertainty ellipse which is very thin in the z direction and very wide in the x and the y direction. It's like a pancake, and you can use it for metrology by rotating this pancake and trying to detect the rotation angle. So it's not like a fully polarized state. It does not have any spin expectation value, so all spin expectation values are zero. But again, this guy is also zero, but the variances in the other two directions are large. So you can rotate this pancake and use it for metrology. It has been done experimentally in this paper, and we also analyze this metrology setup in this other paper. So now we see that Dicke states are interesting. They could detect multipartite entanglement in them. And it would be interesting to look for bipartite entanglement. Why is this a common, so why is it an important point? Now I talk about detecting bipartite entanglement in Dicke states. Because, you know, all these experiments were in a BEC, and many people would say that in the BEC, all atoms are at the same place. So how can one talk about entanglement in an ensemble where all atoms are in the spatial, occupy the same spatial state? And so this is a question because usually entanglement is mentioned in the context of two systems being at a different point, and we make correlation measurements and we see entanglement that way. So now comes the question, is multipartite entanglement within a BEC is real, useful, or it is just a consequence of, let's say, bosonic symmetrization? And we answer the question that yes, it is useful and it is real. So the basic idea is the following, that imagine that here there is a BEC, and we let it expand, and the particles hit various detectors. And the claim is that if the detectors only detect the position of the particles, then if originally you had one atom in, let's say, zero state, another atom in one state, then at the end you will get a singlet at the two detectors, so 0, 1, plus 1, 0. So it means that in the condensate you had two atoms occupying the same spatial state, you let the condensate expand, and after you detect the position, you get two distinguishable atoms in a singlet state. So this way you could get out the entanglement, which is quotation mark due to symmetrization, and you obtain distinguishable particles. And it was shown that a similar idea works for many particles. So if you have a condensate and you split it, then if the original system was multipartite entangled, then you get bipartite entanglement between the two halves. You have to also consider projecting to a fixed particle number state, but I think this is a subtlety I would not analyze at the moment. So, and in at the University of Hannover, in the group of Karsten Klemm, they realized an experiment along these lines. So I would say some details about the experiment. So the experiment was done with spin 1 atoms. Initially, all atoms were in a zero state. And then the dynamics causes pairs of atoms to tunnel from 0, 0 to the plus 1 and the minus 1 state. In a sense, one of the atoms goes to plus 1, the other goes to minus 1. We don't know which one goes which way. Because of that, from a 0, 0, you get a singlet state of in the plus 1, minus 1 subspace. But it works similarly for a larger number of atoms. So at the end, what you have is you start out n atoms in the zero state, but then you have at the end n minus 2 n atoms, or two lowercase n atoms in the zero state, while lowercase n are in the plus 1 and the lowercase n in the minus 1 state. So at the end, you have a 2 n Dicke state. So this is now in a mode picture. And if I think now about these as particles, then essentially what I have 2n particles in the Dicke state. This was the way they created the Dicke state. And what they did is that they used the first excited spatial mode of the trap rather than the ground state mode. And so the ground state mode in a harmonic oscillator is has a single bump. And the first excited state has two bumps. And they made this Bose-Eisntein condensate in this two-bump spatial state. And afterwards, it was possible to detect entanglement between these two. So, and this is published, has been published very recently in Science. So this is the paper. So now I explain basic ideas of entanglement detection. So again, you have to measure something on the left-hand side, something on the right-hand side. A and B denotes the two wells. And the statement is that for separable states, for example, this quantity is always larger than n over 2. And if it is smaller than this value, then you know that the state is entangled. The derivation is very simple. For product states, the collective variances are just the sums of individual system variances. And you know that, let's say, variance of Jx plus variance of Jy plus variance of Jz for a spin is always larger than J, in this case, Na over 2. For the other, the B system, okay, so it should be B here. It's Nb over 2, and this is then just N over 2, the total particle number over 2. And a similar criteria would work for Dicke states, when I imagine that half of the atoms are on the left-hand side and half on the right-hand side, the only point I have to put here a minus. So you remember that the variance of the collective observable was large, but one can show that the variance of the difference between the two is small. And you also remember that Jz had a zero variance for the Dicke state. So this could really detect entanglement of the Dicke state, but it has some problems because it tolerates noise not so well, and it assumes symmetry. So we have to sort of find another way. And so we start from another uncertainty relation, which is just from the Heisenberg uncertainty for a spin. And we obtain this nice relation where this is Jz square plus a constant times the variances in the other directions, normalized with the second moments. So rather than the square of first moments, the second moments. So So now, if we were a little bit technical, but at the end, I think the form will be quite simple. So we take now uncertainty, angular momentum operators properly normalized. So this is now M can be X or Y, N can be A and B for the left and right well, and we normalize it with the number of particles over 2, so basically the spin of the well. So then this thing is between plus 1 and minus 1, and this other quantity sort of measures how close we are to the symmetric subspace. So it is around 1 if we are in the symmetric subspace or close to it, and in general it's smaller than 1. Then with this we can rewrite the previous uncertainty relation like this. So as you see that it's much simpler. And so far this is a single system, but we have two systems. So we now define the sum of the individual JZ angular momenta and also the difference between the X and Y components of the angular, this tilde angular momenta. And we can write now our condition. So the statement is that for separable states this is true, and any state that violates it is entangled. So I would not show the derivation now, but I have it at the end of the slides. So what does it say? First of all, for symmetric states this is 1, and for separable states it's either this is small and that is big, or this is big and the other is small, and if both of them are small enough, then we know that the state is entangled. So more or less, this explains. So the statement. So imagine that for Dicke states, this Jz square is small. As I said, this variance is small but not close to zero. It's somewhere here. And the red was the condition of the three variances. The blue is our condition. And if a point corresponds to so if a state corresponds to a point below this line, then we know that it is entangled, and the ideal Dicke state is below the red line at variance Jz0. And this now has a somewhat nicer form if you consider symmetric states. So this is this is just the curve, the blue curve. I think this is much easier to understand intuitively. But why we needed this more complex form? Because we have to deal with the fact that you don't have symmetric states, and the particle number varies. So here come the real experimental problem in many cold atom experiments, that if you repeat the experiment, you never have the same particle number. So many theoretical models assume that you have a given particle number, you repeat many times, and somehow you assume you have 10,000 particles. But in reality, you have a mixture of states with different particle numbers, and with a very high probability, actually, you never get the same particle number in a series of experiments. But you still have to say whether this state is entangled or not. And it's easy to see that rho is entangled if and only if one of the rho, JA, JB, are entangled. So in principle, one could just wait enough time that you can reconstruct all the JA, rho, JA, JBs. But as I said, you don't have enough time, so you have to sort of claim that this rho is entangled such that you don't have enough data to reconstruct rho JA, JB. And so it's a challenge, and one has to make the entanglement condition such that it contains the particle number and does not group the experimental results depending on particle numbers on different, let's say, boxes. And so here, it means that, for example, if you want to calculate the expectation value of an operator that depends on the particle number, then you have to proceed like this. So here, A does not depend on the particle number. So again, this GA is just NA over 2. So this part depends. And you can calculate these expectation values like this. And with this interpretation, our formula works such that the particle number can vary in the two sides. So it means that you remember that this have this normalization with JA. So it's possible to calculate this after each experiment. You get a quantity which contains the particle number, and if it is violated, then we know that the state is entangled, even if we don't have enough data for, let's say, particle number 1000. So for a given particle number. So now let's see how this Dicke state looks like. So what I said, this guy is close to zero. So the variance is big, but the variance of the difference, so variance of the sum is big, but the variance of the difference is small in the x and y direction. And in the jz direction, it's zero, ideally. So then you can interpret it like this, that if you make measurements on the left-hand side, then you can predict measurement results on the right-hand side. So in the x and y direction, you expect to measure the same thing, and in the z direction, your expectation is that you will measure the opposite. So and here, so these figures explain. So you see that this is on the left-hand side, they measure JZ. On the right-hand side, they measure JZ as well. And indeed, you get more or less one of them is minus one times the other. And here, they measure this quantity, which is simply J in the JX, JY plane, an angular momentum component. And they measure the same component on the left, on the right-hand side. And here, they seem to be very close to each other. When this is 1, the other is also 1. When this is 0.5, the other is also 0.5. And let me explain this figure. So the Dicke state on this block sphere corresponds to a ring. So the uncertainty ellipse is a pancake, as I said. But in terms of this representation, sort of as a Wigner function on the sphere, it is a ring. And then when they split it, then these two figures represent what happens. So JZ, so this is the spin, which has a positive JZ component, and this other one, now because of that, has a negative JZ component. On the other hand, the two arrows in the XY plane point in around the same direction. So you're just summarizing these figures. So now, let's see the other measurement results. So you see that they made an experiment for a range of particle numbers. And this is the shot noise level, this solid line. And this is the collective angular momentum variance. So this is what is small for Dicke states. And indeed, they measure something very small. Then here, this thing is this normalized Jx square plus Jy square. So the normalized Jxa minus Jxb, and they measure these quantities, and afterwards they plug this in into the formula, but they also need this third thing, which, if you remember, describes how symmetric the state is. So why is this symmetric? Symmetry matters because ideally the state should be symmetric. So in a BEC, if you have two state atoms, then they are in a symmetric state if the BEC is in a single spatial state. But in practice, you cannot expect that you are in a single spatial state, so it will be not fully symmetric, the internal state of the atoms, but still it's quite close to one. So this is the quantity. You see that in principle should be one if the state is symmetric. And this is important because in many experiments they deal with bosonic modes, and they always assume that, or typically, that they are fully symmetric. It's a single bosonic mode, but it's a single bosonic mode only if you are in a single spatial state, and this ideally does not happen perfectly. So, and now this is the criterion, what I mentioned. So it has a left-hand side and a right-hand side, and of course, in order to detect entanglement, this part should be below the right-hand side. And so one is the bound for symmetric states. So if we have a symmetric state, then this right-hand side is one. But It's not exactly one, it's somewhat lower. And the left-hand side is this product. You can see it here for various particle numbers. And it's clear that this is larger than the other one, or the left-hand side is below the right-hand side, and because of that, they can detect entanglement. So I would like to mention the collaborators on this project. So it's, they are from my group. As I said, Giuseppe Vitaiano, Jakob Apeianis, Matthias Kleiman, Philip Hillus, Inigo Eguskica, who is a faculty member at the university. And from Hannover, the participants were Carsten Lange, Jan Peise, Ben Lücke, Ilka Kruse, Luis Santos, and Carsten Klemt. So they are now not only the people who worked on this double well experiment, but they are also the people who worked on these previous Dicke state problems. And so now I summarize what I was mentioning here. So I discussed the detection of bipartite entanglement close to Dicke states. But before, I also mentioned other experiments and entanglement detection schemes concerning Dicke states. So the importance of this work was that it showed that multipartite entanglement of a Bose-Eisntein condensate can be transformed into bipartite entanglement, which is needed in many quantum information processing applications. And what is an important point in this condition that it handles non-symmetric states. Of course, the state is close to symmetric, but we don't assume that it is symmetric. And it also handles properly varying particle numbers. So we don't assume, let's say, a constant particle number without including particle number variance. And you can see our work in this paper. And you can also, I will put my transparencies on my homepage, but you can also look for other information on my homepage. So thank you very much.